pleasure to be with you this morning. Thank you. And I write about where the puck is going. You may be able to tell that I'm Canadian, not American, and I'm super happy to be Canadian because of this. So, although I live in America, my firm is American. Just quick background: University Ventures is a private equity fund, so we invest in and around the sector, primarily in the U.S. We have a couple of investments outside the U.S. But what that does is it gives us a terrific vantage point from which to look at the changes that are occurring in the system and where we can sort of add capital to help fuel innovation and development. The U.S. election, education was not a huge issue in the election, certainly not on the Republican side. On the Democrat side, it was a major component of the platform with Hillary Clinton's plan, a proposal for effectively free college, more of a European-type model. What's interesting about that is, and of course that came from the fact that college affordability in America had gotten to the point where you have $1.3 trillion in outstanding student loans. The average student who partakes of student loans, which is something like 80% of all students in America, they graduate with about $35,000 in debt. And then, of course, that doesn't that leaves out the many students who take on debt but don't complete a credential, which really is the major affordability problem. So, what I'm going to do today is talk to you about what the scenario looks like in the U.S. And I think that a lot of it is probably going to be relevant to some degree to the European context, but that may be something that we can discuss afterwards. But again, this is a vantage point U.S., what's happening in the U.S. higher education system, as I like to say with my Canadian background, where the puck is going in higher education. We try and skate, as Wayne Gretzky said, we try and skate to where the puck is going. But nobody saw this coming. No one saw this coming just because no one thought Brexit coming. And one reason, a symptom of that is the fact that the free college argument was important to the vast majority of Clinton supporters, but relatively unimportant to Trump supporters. And why is that? Why did Trump supporters not care much about this crisis of college affordability? Well, we would argue it's that for many Trump supporters, college feels like a fantasy. It feels like it's unaffordable, unattainable, can't complete it. Many of them have tried and failed. America is unique globally for having a very high percentage of its population matriculate into postsecondary education programs, 70%. But only about half of those who actually begin complete. So you have this, very, very wide funnel, but it narrows. And then over the course of that, as I said, lots of students taking on debt, incurring costs, and not graduating with any credential of value. So that's the challenge. And what our view of this and our explanation, one explanation of the electoral disaster that occurred last year is that higher education, at least in the United States, used to be for a very, very elite population. The bachelor's degree originated as a product to serve the sons of the merchant elite in New England towns in America. And then after the war, in the 50s through the 1980s, it expanded. It expanded through the general population. But the products, the diversity of products did not expand to it. It was simply a one-size-fits-all solution. The bachelor's degree fits everyone. And, you know, again, as I said, only 50% of students who start this 120-credit four-year program actually complete it. And on the other side, just as universities are guilty of this isomorphic monoculture of the degree in America, employers and hiring managers are also responsible because they've developed and accepted this system of degree and pedigree-based hiring, where over the last 30 years, jobs that one never would have thought would have required a bachelor's degree now include a bachelor's degree requirement because you have millions of qualified candidates, and a bachelor's degree is a useful, arguably useful filter for filtering out those who, you know, are probably not qualified. You just don't know. So as a result, we have this huge skill gap where basically half the population in America feels shut out of the economy because they do not have the requisite credential that you need for really any job that anyone would want. Right? If you don't have a bachelor's degree in America, you simply cannot get a good job in a growing sector of the economy, period. Because of the combination, again, of universities and this model, isomorphic monoculture of degrees, and employers and hiring managers who've adopted it as the primary screen for really any professional job. I would argue in a fairly lazy, thoughtless manner. And so the result is you have the skills gap where, yes, there's 8 million unemployed and 5 million job seekers, but the bigger problem, and as represented by the election, is that you have probably about 30 million who are underemployed, who could do a lot more, but the fact is they don't have the formal credential to get past that hiring screen that employers utilize. And increasingly, the way hiring works in America, and I'm confident that it's similar here to some extent, is that technology has actually made hiring more challenging because every job that's posted online generates 200, 300 applications. No human hiring manager is going to look at that many applications. And so what happens is you have what's called an applicant tracking system software that filters candidates out before a human hiring manager can look at them. And one of the key criteria in those applicant tracking systems is the degree. So if you don't have a degree, you're never seen. You're invisible, effectively, to the human hiring manager. And that's, I think, part of the problem is Trump voters felt invisible. They feel invisible to the broader economy. And that is an explanation for what's happened in the United States. And again, I lay the blame to a large extent at the feet of our wonderful system of higher education, as well as the employers who consume the product of higher education. We're seeing great debt dissatisfaction in America, even before the election, around the system of higher education. The enrollment of the for-profit universities, you're all familiar with the University of Phoenix and so forth, they're sort of the canary in the coal mine. Right? They're the least viable value proposition. You've seen their enrollment fall by half over the last 5 years. In addition, small schools, small private and mid-sized, both private and state institutions, their enrollments are falling. Last year, 70% effectively failed to meet their budget enrollment. On the other side, alumni, and this is new in the last 10 years, since the recession, alumni, about half of alumni don't feel that it was a good investment. And these are alumni who graduated. Right, those who didn't complete obviously don't get really good investment. So you're only 38% of younger alumni. You're also seeing employers, signs from employers that the product, the degree, is not entirely useful. You've got firms like Google who are saying degrees aren't useful. We're going to simply implement our own tests and hire on that basis. You've got firms like Ernst & Young and Pricewaterhouse and Penguin Random House. We're either saying we're going to remove the degree requirement entirely for entry-level hires into our organizations, or we're going to, in some cases, mask whether or not a candidate has a degree because we feel for some jobs a degree is actually not correlated, maybe inversely correlated in some cases, to employee performance. Also in the U.S., the market for fully online degree programs is basically flat. So we had a huge growth from about 2000 through to about 2011-12, and for the last 5 years, you really haven't seen growth in the total number of students studying entirely. I hope we have time to get to that. The president of Purdue, Mitch Daniels, the former governor of Indiana, said, I think it's very apropos, higher education has to get past the takeout route. That's really what it was. It was, get a bachelor's degree, it's going to be worth it no matter how hard it is, no matter how much it costs, and so forth. Increasingly, in America, people aren't taking their word for it. So, I'm going to touch on this topic, which is employability. One of the most significant, perhaps the most significant change in American higher education over the last decade. About a decade ago, only about 50% of students at the point of entry, at the point of matriculation into their tertiary education program, reported that the primary or sole reason for doing so was related to employment or getting a job. Today, that percentage is about 93%. So we have a much more practical, hard-headed generation of students who know why they're there and what they want. The challenge, of course, is that a system, not surprisingly, isn't doing a very good job of producing employable graduates. Only about 20% of American students who graduate have a job at the point of graduation. And only 11% of employers think that graduating students have the competencies that their business would need. So this is the source of the skills gap. One thing I want to talk about, I want to make an analogy from Silicon Valley, if I can. So, you'll Microsoft, for example. Microsoft organized its business in terms of providing slices of the technology stack. It provided the operating system, Windows. It provided the Office applications. But it wasn't in the business of providing the hardware. It wasn't in the business of providing the complete user experience. Right? Contrast that to Apple. Right? Apple and Steve Jobs and famously controlling. He wanted to control everything. He wanted to control the product design, the packaging, the retail experience, everything for the student. We can see the relative performance of those companies over the last 15 years. Right? The full stack model, controlling the full stack, really, really works for Apple. Look at the, if you're familiar with the company Uber. Before Uber came along, there were probably a half dozen companies that tried to disrupt the taxi or limousine dispatching market by developing better dispatching software. It didn't work, right? Because no matter how efficiently the cars are dispatched, if you're still sitting in the back of a dirty taxi, it doesn't really change the value proposition for the consumer. So enter Uber. Uber comes along and says, we're a technology company, but we're going to take ownership of the full customer experience. We're going to make sure that we're going to rate our drivers. Drivers are going to be responsible. And in some cases, in my state, California, they're actually drivers that might have to become employees. So they really are taking control of the entire experience. And that has been incredibly disruptive to that market. We would argue that, if you think about higher education and creating a university, the sort of a full stack university, what's the biggest piece that's missing? What's at the top of the stack? And we would argue it's employment and employability, literally taking responsibility for getting that student the job, which is, mind-blowing for lots of people in higher education. I'm going to talk about a lot of examples here where that's changing in America and where that may need to change globally as well. Continue to have a viable value proposition in higher education. So we're the largest investor in this company. It's called Galvanize. It's a coding bootcamp. So it sort of sits. These just-in-time models. These are models that sit at the end of the traditional tertiary experience, providing just-in-time or last-mile training, technical training, that leads to the job. And some of them are actually guaranteeing the job. Some of them are just, you know, making that connection and getting 95% of students employed in those jobs. Not all of them are in coding. Some of them are in business skills, for example. And most of them are top-up programs. So at the left-hand side, these are programs where you typically go in with a bachelor's degree. It costs an additional $10,000 to $15,000, last 3 months, and boom, you land in a great job, a high-paying job, $60,000 to $80,000 a year to start. It's a great job. But we're beginning to see the emergence of these alternative models. These alternative models, typically targeting low-income, low socioeconomic students. But it's truly a full step where you're taking a student at a secondary school and providing a combination of cognitive, non-cognitive, and technical training, literally placing them into a job. There's no credential, really, at the end of it. But you know, they would argue the credential is the job, and that's really what students are caring about now. We agree. This gives you a sense of what galvanizes. This is one of those pop-up programs, coding boot camps. It doesn't look like a traditional school because it's actually a co-working space. So you have, and this is the San Francisco campus, you have about 100 different companies who are based there in that space. And you have Google and IBM and other big companies with teams there as well. These companies are literally providing curriculum into the program, and they're hiring students right out of this 3 month or 6 month long program. So entirely focused. And, you know, we're very interested in the question of, you know, can you imagine similar models in other industries as well, where they might start as top-up programs but eventually evolve into full-stack programs and essentially competing with what we know as traditional post-secondary education. You know, one thing that we think a lot about is that, you know, I like to call it sort of, we're in the era of Netflix, right, where we've become, if you will, spoiled by a very clean interface. Right? And I think that as a result, we're less tolerant of poor interfaces, whether digital or physical. Right? So, you know, it used to be, you know, 10 years ago, you would go to the California Department of Motor Vehicles, right? Which is in America's work, that is synonymous with like a terrible interface, a terrible customer experience. And I know that when I go into a DMV, a lot less tolerant than I might have been 5 years ago or 10 years ago before everything was easy and intuitive. And also, if you think about galvanized, it's a very easy and understandable interface. Right? The value proposition is clear. Right? You know what you're going to get. You know what you're going to get. It's clean. It's a nice environment. You know, very different from many of America's post-secondary institutions. So, you know, think about sort of who's going to be able to provide this sort of clean interface that students are demanding. So, you know, we think a lot about how colleges are going to fill this gap and address this major issue. We call it this intersection pre-hire training. It's the question of who's going to provide that last mile training that employers need in order to make that hire and get these students jobs. And it may not be necessarily from students from degree programs, it may be from alternative models, pop-up programs, disruptive credentials, and so forth. So these are the skills, these are the components of what's required. And we've got a whole market now in America. You can see that, you know, there are models where B2C is the students paying for this last-mile training, B2B is the employer paying, and B2U is the university. And for a combination of training or matching and placement services. And here are the range of companies that have emerged in America. These companies are all less than 5 years old that are doing this themselves or partnering with universities to do this. So this is a very fast-growing sector of a lot of our activity. One thing we think a lot about is, like when I graduated a long time ago, there were pathways, right? There were clear pathways to employment But those pathways to employment, right, where you have major companies that are coming and recruiting on campus and so forth, they're only in a handful of areas, right? Management consulting, investment banking. Today one would argue that those aren't the high-value jobs of the future. The high-value jobs are in technology, they're in biotechnology, they're in healthcare. So these are the jobs, and these are the jobs that students want. But where are these pathways? Where are these clear pathways to entry-level positions in this field? So that's what we think a lot about. But how do you provide these easy and clear, with a clean interface, pathways to these jobs where there's huge demand? There's something like, in America, over a million unfilled jobs in coding, literally computer program, a million unfilled jobs. Where's the pathway? So we believe that this is causing the emergence of these intermediaries. That slide I just showed you with all these different companies, these are intermediaries that are trying to occupy this space, this middle ground. And it makes sense, right? Because if you have thousands of universities trying to match millions of students to millions of employers, no one university or no one employer is going to be able to take on all those relationships. So you really need an intermediary to understand what employers are looking for, to understand what the status of the talent supply is, provide whatever last-mile training is required, staff in place. And so that's what we're seeing. And this is actually a company that we've just invested in. This is a company that provides free last-mile training to students. And what they do is they actually, so it's a three-month free boot camp. And then Revitur will hire. They hire the student, and then they will staff them out to the employer. And their revenue model is simply the delta between what they're charging the employer for the resource and what they're paying the student. Then after a year, the student can go and work for the employer. The employer will hire the student. So this sort of staffing model, we think, is really, really interesting. You see, higher education from time immemorial has only focused on this top left quadrant. Right? This is a paid program, and there's no guaranteed outcome. So if you change your mindset to more of a staffing mindset, you can provide a free program. You can employ it. Provide a program like Revitur does, a training program, where the student doesn't pay anything because it's the employer who's going to pay on the back end, as I just described. You can provide a guaranteed outcome because actually that intermediary, Revitur, hires the student. So Revitur's value proposition is if you complete this training program, this free training program, we will hire you. We will hire you. And that'll get you, and that'll be your first job. And then when our client hires you, that'll be your second job. So that's what that's what we're seeing. We see this as incredibly disruptive. And here are these very large staffing companies that we see moving very much in our direction. So when universities in America or here sort of think about, what's our competition down the road? It's not University of Phoenix. It might be these guys, these staffing companies, because once they begin integrating pre-hire training into what they're doing, they show you how to sort of discuss here. So Revitur, the company I just mentioned, they just announced partnerships with 7 different universities to put these free coding boot camps on their campuses. So CUNY, the City University of New York, is one where they're going to have coding boot camps all over CUNY for free, hiring hundreds, if not thousands, of graduates right out of CUNY after they train them. Right now, that program is only for students who've completed a bachelor's degree program 4 years. But what's to say that it can't be after 2 years, or even after 1 year? Why does it need to be a 4+ Revitur? Why can't it be a 2+ Revitur or a 1+ Revitur? So I'm waiting for that university to come to Revitur to say, I think we could enroll 10,000 more students if we offered a 1+ Revitur model. And that really would be disruptive to this monoculture, this isomorphic monoculture of the bachelor's degree. We've just invested in this new company. they take it one step further, which is to say, you know, why should we stop at simply just doing the technical training? Why don't we do everything? Why don't we completely disrupt the bachelor's degree? So what Mission U, this is not been announced yet, but they'll be announcing in February, is a Silicon Valley-based company. This is a one-year pathway where they provide 6 months of cognitive and non-cognitive skills training, 3 months of technical training, and then 3 months of placement into the employer. And there's your job. What's the credential? The credential is the job. And that's what students care about. You know, they don't necessarily care about having a bachelor's degree, they care about having a job. So this is truly a disruptive credential. And as I wrote a couple weeks ago, you know, the moment that the son or daughter, a friend of the son or daughter of a New York Times writer or editor opts for Mission U as opposed to admission to Brown University, you know, if you thought that, you know, MOOCs or coding boot camps was a big deal, you're not going to hear the end of this. You know, it really will be the beginning of the unbundling of the degree, which I come to. So that's sort of where we're headed in the American market. And that brings us to unbundling. So this is the book that I come out last year. You know, seen it. What is unbundling? Well, degrees, I would say they're the currency of the labor market, as I pointed out, for good and large part for ill, as we saw with last week's election. But in terms of, you know, a usefulness as a currency, they're about as useful as this currency. This is the giant stone coins on the island of Yap in the South Pacific, which actually was used as currency. You can't really move them. You can't really pick them up. You try to pick it up, you'll probably fail. So, you know, that's the bundle. And honestly, a lot of Trump voters will look at 120 credits in 4 years and say, you know, that's like trying to pick up this giant stone coin. So what is unbundling? Well, we've seen unbundling that happen in music already. Remember, we used to buy music on albums or cassettes or CDs. We don't buy music in bundles anymore. In America now, we're seeing the unbundling of our television. We used to have to buy cable packages, which included, you know, 100 different channels. Now you can basically pick your channels and increasingly directly pick and pay for your shows if you want to buy. So that's unbundled. When you unbundle, you are, in a microeconomic context, you are literally transferring producer surplus to consumers. It is going to happen if the technology allows it. And a bachelor's degree or a master's degree or a doctor is a bundle. It's a bundle with a lot of different requirements and things. We are bundling. And lots of universities also bundle, you know, athletic fees, room and board, library access, you name it. It's bundled up in there. Lots of students would prefer, if they had the option, less of a bundled environment. You also, I don't have the slide in here, but you also have, of course, in America, you know, dozens of universities that are building crazy rock climbing walls and lazy rivers and facilities that have nothing to do with the university's mission, and bundling that into the cost of the degree program. That's also going to be unbundled. So what happens when we unbundle? What is the future look like? Well, clearly, if we could have a currency that was based on competencies, it would be a lot better, a much finer grained currency. We're describing for, you know, any one student hundreds of competencies, right? Those competencies would be the currency that would transact across all corners of this triangle. Students to educational providers to employers. That would be ideal. And when I say competencies, I know that, you know, whenever I speak to an academic or university audience, and at least in America, competencies has a connotation of sort of vocational, meaning that, you know, it is sort of, you know, mid-skill employment, blue-collar. That's not what I mean when I describe competency. Competency is really any capability that can be assessed. Right? It relates to higher order thinking skills, communication skills, problem solving skills, executive function skills that are most predictive of career success across, you know, virtually any profession. These are the kinds of competencies that we're In my book, I talk about the emergence of competency marketplaces, and that's where we're going. The notion that we'll all have competency profiles. Your LinkedIn profile will become a competency profile, which is not to say that it's going to be intelligible to the to the typical human reader or hiring manager, but it will be intelligible to machines and applicant tracking systems, and it will basically provide a summation of your competencies across hundreds of them, across various levels, and will be it won't be perfect, but will provide and there are lots of different ways in which that's going to occur. It's not just going to be simply a text description. It may actually be test scores. It may be work product, which is literally posting up there that machines are able to derive competencies from your papers, your presentations, your problem sets, and so forth. And once you have a profile of your competencies, they'll be matchable to employers. They'll be searchable and matchable to employers. So employers will be able to filter. So remember, I described earlier how applicant tracking systems are filtering out candidates who might otherwise be qualified. In a competency marketplace model, that doesn't happen anymore. It's literally moving from a pedigree or degree-based hiring model to a competency-based hiring model, where the candidates that a hiring manager will see and interact with are candidates that are better matched in terms of competencies, and hopefully predictive competencies, competencies we actually are able to recognize that the kinds of candidates who perform well within our organization are candidates who exhibit these competencies at this stage in their career, this stage of their development. And those are the ones that should be out there targeting. And by the way, I might do it proactively. So I might actually go after a student in their second year of their tertiary education program and say, based on your profile, you actually look like you could be a good candidate for me in a year's time or 2 years. And let's begin to interact, and here's some project work, and here's some coursework I would suggest for you. Here's a virtual internship. These are the kinds of interactions that competency marketplaces are going to enable. LinkedIn hopes to become the first competency marketplace. They call it an economic graph. It's the same thing. Essentially, they want to connect every job with every person on the planet on the basis of competencies. They bought a company 2 years ago called Bright.com for $120 million. What they did was they developed a really good engine for parsing job descriptions and extracting competencies from those job descriptions, doing the same on the resume side and matching them. So that's where they're heading. We don't think that they're going to be the only winner. We're not an investor in anything. We are an investor in lots of other companies that are doing this. So and this is to give you a sense of where they're going. And we fundamentally believe this is transformative for higher education. What it does is, today, it really is a faith-based system, right? Students have to have faith that the academic program they're pursuing, and in America at least paying for, is one that's going to pay off. But they don't really have any, what we would call a GPS, goal positioning system for their human capital development. Competency marketplaces are a GPS for human capital development. You'll know where you are, not on an hourly or even a daily basis, but on a, semester to semester, term to term basis. You'll have a sense of where your competencies are, how they develop, as something new emerges in your zone of proximal development. Is there a new career path? Are there, other fields you should be considering based on the competencies you're exhibiting? This is all derived from the supposition that the gap between what the workforce needs and what higher education is provided, on the other hand, is a data gap. It's simply just a lack of information. And so higher education has been free, largely, to do what it wants. In America, at least, what I'm suggesting is those days have come to an end. That increasingly, the supply side, the talent supply side, is going to be driven by the talent demand side. The talent demand side is now pretty pushing the data out and not responding very well to the product that our current system is supporting. And I would suggest, I think that what's happening in America now is probably going to be the model globally within a decade or so. So in America, we're waking up to the emergence of these competency marketplaces, which could well become, within a decade, the way in which any student, you're not just simply going to go online and search for a college or a program. You'll go based on your competency profile and you'll see what the marketplace recommends, right? Here's where I am. Here's what I want to be. I want to be an environmental engineer. Great, okay. Here's the gap between where you are and where you want to be. And here's the quickest path between you and the least expensive path to get. And you're not going to get, to 100% coverage of the copy. You'll get to 90%. Enough so that you'll know that you'll make it through the applicant tracking system to be considered for employment. What do I need to get from here to there? Competency marketplace is going to tell me. I'm not going to decide myself. I'm not going to be told by a guidance counselor or an educational consultant. I'm not going to be convinced by marketing from any one institution. I'm going to look on my screen. It's going to tell me what I need and how I need to get there. So you have some schools like Stanford that are trying to do more in terms of outputting more data, making it visible to employers, not just simply the transcript, which is ignored. It's a useless document right now in the hiring process, literally from the time you graduate. No one ever looks at your transcript again. But what I'm suggesting is that we're moving from a model. So you'll recall the way we all used to buy software, we would buy enterprise software. Right? A decade ago, if your organization needed a new ERP system or some big software system, you go to PeopleSoft or a company like that, and it would be a huge implementation. You spend hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars. You're in a big company, a big government organization, to implement one of these enterprise software systems, which is to say you pay a lot of money to buy everything all at once. And then you find you probably only use 10% of the functionality of that system. Right? That's effectively what we're doing in higher education today. It's a one-time purchase. You spend a lot of money for a degree, and then once you're done, you don't think about it again. Right? Well, how do we buy software today? The software we buy is a SaaS model, right? In America, at least, you're buying software as a service. You're renting your software. You're paying for the functionality you need, and you're paying for only what you need when you need it. Right? So I talk in my book about the example of Adobe. Adobe used to require, every graphic design creative artist, to buy their creative enterprise license. About 3 years ago, they shifted to Creative Cloud because they knew that their customers weren't happy. You shouldn't need to spend $5,000 just to use a couple of functionalities to take photographs, modify them, and upload them to the web. Customers weren't happy. So now you have Creative Cloud where that kind of functionality now costs you $15 a month, and that's all you pay. And they now have a very fast-growing business again with Adobe. So that shift from enterprise to SaaS is wrenching for Adobe, but well within because now they're growing again. For higher education, what does that mean? Well, it means providing what students need when they need it. But the potential is that you have a lifetime customer. It's not just a one-time customer. If you can literally have your finger on the pulse of that student's competency profile, understand where they're heading in their career trajectory, provide them what they need when they need it in order to move ahead. That's great. That's a great model. That'll work for higher education. There's some challenges to that, as I described, but that's the opportunity here. It's both a threat and an opportunity. So we see the evolution of these competency marketplaces. We're investors in these companies. Credly is an emerging competency marketplace around micro-credentials or badging. It's taking the degree and segmenting it down into hundreds of micro-credentials or badges so you can stack them. Portfolium is an e-portfolio competency marketplace. So it's been adopted in Thailand. Virtually the whole state of California has adopted it. So every University of California, Cal State University, California Community College has adopted portfolio. And what it is students post their work. So papers or problems like their presentations, portfolio derives their competencies from that work and then matches them out to employers. So they have employers like Oracle, for example, who are searching for new sales engineers. They post that job, and portfolio is able to say, based on the work product of students, here are the 500 students you should be interviewing from across the state of California. That's interesting to Oracle. That's information they didn't get before in the old degree or pedigree-based hiring model. So that's interesting. So the next step for, as we sort of see the emergence of these competency marketplace, and this is to say that I don't think that LinkedIn is going to be the only winner. As Portfolium and Credly and other emerging marketplaces begin to integrate with these applicant tracking systems, Taleo is leading this in Oracle product. This is kind of the market for applicant tracking systems. So then what happens is that employers can then basically post the job internally on their own applicant tracking system and then reach out into these competency marketplaces and pull candidates in and begin interacting with them. So that's the next step. And then finally, what's going to happen here is that, if you've heard of this phrase, people analytics, what that is in the world of human resources, these companies, these employers, are increasingly using IT to get a better sense as to what characteristics drive performance of employees in the organization. So they're really able to profile and say, okay, well, we hired these 50 people in 2013, and here are their profiles, and here's how they've all performed. So here are the top 5 performers of our 2013 hires. Here's their competency profiles. We need to make sure that our job descriptions better reflect these top 5 performers than they do today. And that's going to feed back into the job descriptions, make them much more accurate, and that's just simply going to fuel the emergence of this competency model. So that's how we see this. Keep in mind that the average bad hire costs employees about $15,000. So human resources in America, which is largely overlooked, it's much more valued and central to employers here in Europe than it is in America. But American employers are paying more and more attention to this. And this is, as I say, it's a signal that talent demand, the demand side of the talent economy, is waking up and is going to begin driving the supply side, whereas up until now, we've been largely independent, free to act as we'd like. And so that's changing. Here are these 50 companies I mentioned that are people off the class. Different. These are all emerging competency marketplaces. They're extracting and identifying competencies in different ways, right? Whether job boards, or they're using artificial intelligence, or they're doing it in a gamified way. There's this company, Code Fights, where literally you'll be online and a box will pop up and say, "Can you code better than an Uber engineer? Play a 5-minute game." And if you beat the bot in that game, you're invited for an interview with Uber. So those are the kinds of sort of interesting competency identifications. Again, if you move from a pedigree or degree-based hiring system to a competency-based hiring system, you may find, and this is sort of a somber point, that there's more value to be derived from literally owning that competency profile and delivering higher education. Now, what would you rather be? Would you rather be Uber or an Uber driver? So in this model, right, post-secondary institutions, colleges and universities that are essentially taking candidate A from here, competencies to here, more competencies, they're just the driver. Right? Uber is the one who's sort of directing them, and so who's going to derive the most value from that interaction? Well, it's Uber. Uber gets more value than the driver. The driver just delivering, frankly, fungible can be, lots of different providers can do that. If provider A doesn't want to do it, we'll recommend provider B, we'll recommend driver C. So we may be heading in that direction. And we've posited this question, if your profile is on LinkedIn, who owns that profile? On it? Can you take it back? Can you give it to your university, for your university to own it and manage? Or what if that profile is derived by algorithms that are proprietary to LinkedIn? Right? Do you really own that competency profile? employees is, are you stuck with LinkedIn? You can't move it, right? That's a real question as you think about it. This dystopian, if you will, sort of science fiction version of the future is correct. Who owns the competency profile is going to be a major topic. And I ask this somewhat half facetiously, but not entirely. You know, today, you're all familiar with the debutante. It's this American phenomenon where, you know, the wealthy elite present their daughters to society in this elaborate, you know, expensive ritual. And so today, if someone told me, like, you know, their daughter was coming out of the debutante next week, my reaction would be, that's elitist and expensive and ridiculous, and why are we doing that? And my question is, a decade from now, if someone tells me that their daughter is earning a degree, a bachelor's degree, will I feel the same way as I feel today about someone earning a degree as a debutante? Last part, and so this is a little bit of a footnote, but just to give you a sense, because I know that this is a sort of technology-focused group, give you a sense of, I think, what technology's accomplished in the U.S. so far and what's left to be accomplished. And this is sort of separate and apart from sort of the competency discussion. So very quickly, on campus, there is a consensus, you know, as to what technology can do how it can improve the delivery. So you're all familiar with the phrase flipped classroom. So what's happening is we're taking the flipped classroom and we're taking it a step beyond that. What we're doing is we're integrating formative assessments into the flip. So students arrive in the class and the faculty member has a very clear sense as to what's been understood and what hasn't been understood ahead of time. Is able to delve down into the sort of areas where there's a lack of understanding, make a presentation, have students gather into groups for some active learning, so students can explain to each other. And then students actually will have devices in the class, their iPhones or whatever it is, where they're able to answer questions in real time after that active learning, so the faculty member can ascertain whether or not we've moved forward in our learning. That's much more effective way of delivering education than the typical lecture stage on the stage model. If I had that here, rather than lecturing to you, I would use that. It typically improves learning by 20-40%. The research indicates. So this, we call it a dynamic classroom. It's not moving quickly, particularly because, as you can imagine, it's supposed to work for the students, and it's a lot of work for the faculty member who needs to convert the lecture class they've been teaching forever. This dynamic classroom model, but it's a much more effective way of learning. We're seeing it happen first in professional education, so we have a medical school that's literally converting the entire medical education to this model. The outcomes are consistent with that 20-40% improvement. So it's a lot of work, but there's a lot of benefit to doing this. And this is how technology can improve on campus, in person, through the dynamic classroom model. Relative to online delivery, online delivery has to, there are three promises to it, right? One is accessibility. The other two should be affordability and efficacy. We're only seeing the first one. That's all we've seen so far. So in America, it used to be that there were millions of people for whom post-secondary education was inaccessible. You just simply couldn't get to a campus. Right? Today, anyone who's completed a secondary level education can access higher education through their opportunities. There are literally thousands of online providers now. Virtually every institution in the U.S. Has some online program model. Many of them at the community college level power, they do themselves, but now increasingly at the four-year institution level, they're being powered by these online program management companies, OPMs, including Pearson, and so forth. So we have accessibility, but we've made no progress on affordability or efficacy. It's remarkable. I've talked about how online learning, as it was architected, as a new medium in a field where tradition is everything, and tradition promotes legitimacy and respectability, has literally been modeled on the holy trinity of lecture, discussion, assignment. So that's been the architecture of online learning, and still to this day, it is. Similarly, you wouldn't want to price your online program any less than you price your on-ground program, because if you add a Keynote somehow, that it's less than what you deliver on-ground. And so 95% of U.S. institutions that deliver online programs price it the same way, even though it costs about, if you do it properly, it costs about half of what it costs to deliver an on-ground program. So we have made no progress on affordability whatsoever. And on efficacy, you have all sorts of studies, including from the U.S. Department of Education, that demonstrate that you get as good or better outcomes online. But there's been no study that's actually been able to avoid the self-selection. You know, all of those students who not only opt for online, but don't drop out online, are going to be very, very motivated, much more motivated than your average on-ground students, and typically more mature also. So there really is no sign at all that online delivery is remotely superior, or comparable, let alone superior, to on-ground. The increasing consensus is that it's not. But basically, the quality of what's delivered online is some fraction of what you get on-ground. And I would posit that it won't be until we redesign online learning in a couple of different ways. I'll say one thing about, so we were the ones who laughed at MOOCs back in 2012. In 2012, I wrote an article that compared MOOCs to the Spice Girls, which is to say that, yes, it's a global media phenomenon. It's actually more of the same. We've seen this story before, and we know how it ends. But it did represent something important, right? Which is to say, it represents that every university, no matter how elite or non-elite, needs to have an online or digital strategy, which we agree with. And that is true. One way in which we can begin to attack both affordability and efficacy in online is to make it less complex, simplify. Steve Jobs was very clear, not only was he control freak, but he believed in radical simplification. Complexity is the enemy of completion, which is to say, not to say that a postsecondary program shouldn't be rigorous. It needs to be rigorous, but you shouldn't have to wait in line outside the Department of Motor Vehicles to get a degree. At many community colleges in America, you literally would have to go to 8 different offices to enroll and transfer your credits and so forth. It's incredibly difficult. So, why don't we just simplify? So one way to simplify is to move to competency-based learning. And this is a big topic of discussion, and obviously echoes everything I just described, right? As we move to competency-based hiring, right, colleges and universities will need to speak the language of competencies to be relevant in that world, right? The moment that a student comes to your admissions office and says, well, I've read your program of study and your environmental engineering program looks really interesting, but how is it going to help you take my competency profile from here to where it needs to be to get a job here, according to LinkedIn and the competency marketplace? And if you're not speaking the language of competencies, you're not going to enroll that student, period. So what does that mean? It means you're basically moving from a faculty-centric model to a student, an employer-centric model, where you work with employers, as I said, closing that gap to define what competencies your graduates need to exhibit. And from the competencies, you develop assessments that will demonstrate they exhibit those competencies. And only then, it's almost like an afterthought, only then do we want to worry about the curriculum. So it sounds non-academic, it sounds vocational, it sounds like we're putting in place this, and we are. Because again, that's the world we're heading to, unfortunately. Fortunately or unfortunately. But one good thing about this, from a simplicity standpoint, is that competency-based learning simplifies a lot. What are credits, right? What is failure, right? If you just haven't demonstrated the competencies yet. Once you've demonstrated them, then you'll be a match and you'll move forward. So a lot of the issues that in the U.S. at least produced a 50% dropout rate of the faculty degree programs go away in a competency-based model. However, there are about 800 schools in the U.S. who are actively pursuing competency-based programs. Virtually almost none of them have actually achieved much enrollment success so far. The fundamental, and the reason for that is that competency-based education is not a product, it's a platform. Okay, so think about smartphones think about it. You have a smartphone. There are no apps, and but Android has just come out. So you have a smartphone and Android. How useful is that? That's what competency-based education is. Right? You're speaking the language of competencies. You have the Android platform, but there are no apps. Where are the apps? Once you have that platform, though, you can build all sorts of interesting apps on that platform. That's what's coming. That's what we're waiting for. So there's no, that explains why, you know, no one's enrolled students in these competency-based programs yet. We're waiting for the apps. It's useful. It's necessary, but it's not sufficient. Really quickly, another area in which we think we're going to make progress relative to efficacy is gamification. I talk in my book about Las Vegas and how a generation ago I was there, and you know, the slot machines were kind of in the corner, and they were all sort of dusty, and all the action was at the table, the blackjack tables and the roulette tables and so forth. And now you can't find the tables because you're lost in a maze of slot machines that, you know, have every different color and type and noise and so forth, and it's amazing. And now 70% of casino gambling revenue comes from the slot machines. Why is that? Because slots are the only game that technology has been able to improve to the point where it's like literally sucking money out of the pocket. I mean, that's sort of how effective it is at doing all these things. And so what if we could use that to improve learning? What if we could have that same sort of gamified learning experience? So there's a lot of work going on in this area in the U.S., and I think that until we've made material developments on this front, we're not going to see material improvement in the quality and the outcomes of online education, and similarly on the enrollments, and wholly online. Not blended. Blended continues to grow, but wholly online. Then, of course, there's adaptive learning, right? Being able to assess where you are and deliver the exact appropriate learning object to you at that given time to progress you as rapidly as possible to the desired learning outcome. Well, how do we do that? Well, size matters here. It does. The largest providers are going to have a huge advantage because they're going to have more data, and they're going to be more accurate in serving up those learning outcomes to you. I'll conclude on this note. Everything I just said about online learning is really relevant more for a desktop or laptop environment. In the U.S. now, 60% of students enrolled in early online programs are doing their work entirely on their phones. So, does that work? It doesn't. This model is broken. I talked about before about the Holy Trinity of online learning, the lecture, the discussion, the assessment. It doesn't translate at all. Navigating curriculum is challenging. Discussion boards can work, but it's much shorter posts than faculty are used to, and some of the discussions can work as well. So what we're seeing is the emergence, the LMS discussions we hear about. We think that's almost an anachronism at this point. The LMSs will go away, and then what will take their place are purpose-built apps. But if you look at mobile telephony use in the U.S., right? Very little time is spent on the mobile web, which is effectively what an LMS is when you're on a mobile device. Virtually all the time is spent in apps, purpose-built apps that are built for a specific purpose. So we think you're going to see a Psychology 110 app that is different, and it's fundamentally different from an Economics 210 app and a Bio app. They'll be purpose-built. So the idea that you've got all of your online learning being delivered on a single LMS, I think that's all I've got. So I know that was a lot. Probably different points of view from what you're used to hearing. That's good. Hopefully, I'm happy to answer